Four guys, four games, one winner. Welcome to the war!
It's time to kick ass and chew bubble gum, and I'm all out of gum.
Stay a while and listen.
Come, old breaker!
War never changes.
Snake!
Fight!
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Thumb Culture's brand new podcast, Thumb Wars, where the four of us battle it out to cram out the very best games in every genre. Each week we'll choose four games that we think represent the best of each genre we've selected, then we'll discuss the best and worst reasons as to why they should be in our top three games. This chat represents our opinion and our opinion only. We'll each have 2 minutes to put our point across, and if we deem it worthy, it will be chosen as Thumb Culture's favourite game of all time in that genre. I'm your host, Roscoe Kennison, and I'm joined by Mr. Stuart Shortland.
Hello.
Mr. Paul Collett.
What?
And Mr. Sean Davies.
Hello.
You got to come up with a jollier intro, man. I mean, really.
At least try.
Okay, I'm going to give this another go. Ready?
Okay, hang on.
Ready?
And it's Mr. Sean Davies.
Hello. Is that bad?
No, that was terrifying.
Stay miserable.
Stay miserable, I think.
Treat yourself.
Okay.
Woo! That was awkward for everyone. Hello, that's better. Right. This week we are looking at first person shooters. So we are going to, between us, find the best first person shooter ever made in the history of the world. And going up first this week is... Oh, it's me! It's me. So I've got my four games that I'm going to discuss that I think represent the best of the first-person shooter genre, and I will discuss them now. I need someone to time me on those 2 minutes, please.
I have a timer. Are you ready?
I am ready.
Okay, so after three, what game are you going to discuss first?
This is Halo 3.
Good choice. So after three, one, two, three, go.
Halo 3 represents for me probably the absolute pinnacle of the Halo experience. It's absolutely, you know, fair enough that Halo Combat Evolved came around and blew everyone's collective minds. The controller for the very original Xbox, if you remember, was that big, fat, ugly thing, but it was designed to play freaking Halo. I mean, Halo is the franchise that defined what an FPS is nowadays. And Halo 3 is the antithesis of everything that's good about Halo. There was no weird campaign mixture between the two characters. At least there wasn't a little one, I can't remember. But Master Chief was front and center throughout, and that's what makes it so interesting. For me, it signals the end of the Halo story. Halo 4 and 5 just fell off a fucking cliff. I'm not entirely sure what happened there. But in terms of the campaign of Halo 3, it's certainly the best. What it did introduce to me that made it so fun, though, was the Forge mode, where you could build maps and multiplayer maps. And this is a part of the game that I spent hours playing. I must have dedicated a good portion of my life to just making multiplayer maps for me and my friends to run around in. And I absolutely... just love it. I've always been a big fan of the Halo series, and I think that it's going to stand the test of time. It just needs a little bit of a kick up the ass at the moment. But so far, Halo 3 stands as probably the best game in the franchise. And seeing as that the franchise is a pinnacle of first-person shooters, it stands to reason it's one of the best first-person shooters of all time.
Wow. 1 minute 40. That wasn't bad. That wasn't bad at all.
Thanks, man.
40. Well done.
Cheers, blood.
It's all right,
bro. Are you ready for your second game?
I am ready for my second game.
What is your second game?
My second game is Perfect Dark.
Are you ready after three?
I'm ready after three.
One, two, three, go.
Now, I wasn't going to talk about Perfect Dark. I originally had that other N64 shooter in mind, but it was cruelly taken away from me by someone else who I won't mention right now. But the more I got to think about it, the more I realized that Perfect Dark is an absolutely spectacular shooter. It came off the back of a game which was critically, you know, praised and loved and adored around the world. And Rare gave themselves this massive challenge to create something once they lost the Bond license after GoldenEye, which is still absurd and still hurts to this day. And so what came out of it was Perfect Dark and like 17 missions with Joanna Dark running around Data Design. There was so much in that game which was brand new. So much that we can look at as a source of kind of historical meaning in the sense that Perfect Dark was a very futuristic shooter. There was lots of weapons that you could turn. There was a gun that you could turn into freaking laptops, which was really cool. There was the great protagonist in Joanna Dark, who I really enjoyed handling. You know, handling, that's the wrong word. But taking control of throughout the campaign. There was an awful lot to enjoy, especially the multiplayer. And the multiplayer was fantastic. And, you know, there was co-op as well, which was wonderful. For the N64, it was just a terrific thing. And what I really enjoyed about it was how you could move Joanna around. You could crouch, duck, lean, and drop from all the edges. But there is, you know, you couldn't jump, obviously, because that didn't seem to be a thing of FPS games at the time. But Perfect Dark was a hell of a lot of fun and looked beautiful as well for back in the day. And I do miss playing that game. And hopefully, once I get myself an Xbox One, I can get Rare Replay and play it all over again because there's nothing really like it out there.
Wow, 1:55.
Oh. Ooh. Fine lines.
That was cutting close.
Yeah, well, you know, I love Perfect Dark.
Oh, that could have got dropped off, you know. That was close.
I know, man. I know.
Okay, game number 3.
Game number 3 is BioShock.
Okay, you have 2 minutes starting now.
BioShock is a first-person shooter that was developed by 2K Boston and 2K Australia and published by 2K Games. Suffice to say, it's a 2K-related game. Now, if you say the words BioShock, you know kind of exactly what it is. It's a series which is always so up and down. People seem to love it or absolutely hate it. Luckily for BioShock, in this tournament that I'm currently in, I love it. The spiritual kind of successor to System Shock. Of course, like Ken Levine's fingerprints are absolutely all over this game. And that's what makes it so interesting in the sense that BioShock is a game that's so unique. And for its time, it was so original. You got the campaign, which was so much fun. It was, you know, exploring Rapture and running around was just such a good laugh, really. It was so different to anything else that I'd played at that time, except for maybe System Shock. But, you know, you got the Big Daddies, who I've got a pop vinyl of right now, staring at me, which is quite weird. It became quite iconic in that sense. The guns and the actual shooting mechanics, you know, maybe they're not the best in the world, and probably we've outgrown them since the very original BioShock came out. But in terms of the trilogy, I think BioShock still stands as the best one, even though Infinite is an absolutely spectacular game as well, in my opinion. In my opinion, okay? Deal with it. And so I think that there's so much to love about BioShock, and if you haven't played it yet, I highly recommend grabbing the remaster, which recently came out on the Xbox One and PS4.
1:45. There's a nice average occurring.
You've been practicing, I can tell.
You've got a script, I bet.
Okay, so game number 4 is...
Game number 4. Oh, I love this game. Game number 4 is 13.
Nice. You have 2 minutes starting now.
2003, November 28th, almost 13 years ago to the day I'm talking about this, which is wonderfully coincidental now that I think about it. 13 was a shooter from Ubisoft, which came out on the original Xbox, the PS2, the GameCube, Mac, and Windows. And it was a wonderful, wonderful game. It was a first-person shooter, but it had kind of stealth and action elements. The visuals were completely cel-shaded, which gave it a comic book look, which is, of course, kind of relevant to its comic book origins, which was a graphic novel series back in 1984. What I loved about it so much was how much fun it just it was just fun. You know, shooters can be very serious and they can be very, you know, you've got to be very focused on a lot of them, especially kind of the modern ones. But 13 was just such a good time, just sort of running around. The cel-shaded look, which of course, you know, made it look like a comic book and had that Jet Set Radio kind of look to it as well. You were running around with knives and bazookas and M60s. You could throw bottles and chairs. You could do all sorts of different things. And it obviously hasn't, you know, it didn't have a massive following, so we've never seen it again. But I really would love to see 13 again back on my console. I need a remaster immediately, Ubisoft, so make it happen. I think that, you know, the story was a lot of fun. It was talking about assassinations and presidents and stuff. David Duchovny was in the goddamn game, which was just awesome. And he was a bit battered and bruised at the start of the game. But of course, you build him up and make him better, and it's all good fun. So 13 is a game which, if you haven't played it, it's quite hard to find now. But if you can find it, do it, because it's a lot of fun.
1:55.
Oh, yes!
Jesus.
I'm impressed.
Thanks,
I am
man.
Impressed. Okay. So, well, shall we...
Benchmark, that is.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, we've set a high bar there, Ross. Well, well done.
Thanks, buddy.
So, let's go with Paul then first for the cross-examination.
Oh, sounds painful. Okay, so this is awkward because I've only played a couple of these games, so I'll do my best. Now, Halo 3. Now, I played the original Halo on Xbox, and I did love it, but then my friend deleted the save game, Gary, and so I didn't go back to it. So I was just lost interest in Halo. But then Ross, you know, the kind man that he is, he bought me a copy of Halo 3. And he sent it to me, and I played it. We played it together for a little bit. And, yeah, I didn't really like it that much. It was just, I just didn't get it. It just didn't have that kind of same oomph as the first game. I mean, I'm sure it's a decent shooter, but it didn't really kind of set my imagination on fire. So I kind of quickly said, thank you, Ross. That's a very nice gift, but I didn't play it again. So, sorry, dude.
It's fine.
Perfect Dark. Now, shockingly, I've never played it. I played the remake on the 360, and that was really bad. Yeah. So I've kind of avoided the one on the N64. Bowler Counts is amazing. So I can't really say much about it because I never played it. And Bioshock, I've got a lot to say about Bioshock, but I can say that a bit later if that's okay, because it's kind of relevant to something.
Sure.
And 13, never played that either. But I always got really... really kind of excited by looking at the cell shaded graphics, because I love all that kind of comic book look. So yeah, that's what I'm gonna say, really.
Okay, Stuart.
Bonjour.
Ross, right. What you've got.
I'm not gonna lie, I haven't got much. Halo 3, I was never a Halo fan, so I'll skip over that. Perfect Dark, I vaguely remember playing it. From what I remember, it was a very solid shooter in the same sort of vein as GoldenEye. Sorry, Ross. And it was just fun. It was how games used to be, where you didn't have to worry about, you know, all these different objectives. It was very linear in the way it was, from what I remember. But the way it was, I mean, it's just... It was on the N64, for crying out loud, you know, one of the best controllers, in my opinion, that you could use for a shooter. So I definitely think that's very welcome on the list. Bioshock, I played through some of the first one. Great games, great style, great graphics, great gameplay, freaky as hell. I have just got the remaster recently, so I'm going to be playing through them all again to refresh my memory. Really, I should have done so before this, but never mind. And 13 is a game that I've always loved the styling of. I'm a massive cel-shaded fan. And the one thing that sort of always stood out for me when playing through 13 was the little comic book style pop-ups you used to get when you get a headshot and things like that. And it was just like Ross said, it was just a fun game, and it's a shame that it didn't really sort of come of anything else, really. It could have been a really good series of games by Ubisoft, but unfortunately Ubisoft kind of obviously didn't see it as something to carry on, which is, you know, which is a massive shame. Yeah, all great games apart from Halo, in my opinion.
You will rue the day, my friend. You will rue the day.
I probably will.
I'll get ruined, don't worry.
Come on then, Sean.
Okay then.
Surely, boy.
Me. So, Halo 3. I liked Halo 3, but I preferred ODST and 2 and 1. I think 3, for me, it was always the time when Bungie said, hey, I know, I'm going to try and keep up with everybody else's first-person shooters and try to do something a bit more mainstream with it. And I understand that that went down like a lead balloon for hardcore like Halo fans, but overall shooter fans loved it. And, I you know, that was kind of more my for me. I didn't like 3 as much as I liked ODST or 2 or 1. I think the first two original games are absolutely perfect games, but I think 3... as an overall great game, did more for first-person shooters than every other Halo ever did before that or after that. So, fair enough. I take your meaning. Halo 3 is a good game in that series for some people. Perfect Dark. I think I remember Perfect Dark, but every time I think about it, I think I'm recollecting Perfect Dark Zero something or other. Was the one on the Xbox 360?
Perfect Dark Zero.
That's it, Perfect Dark Zero. So every time I think about it, I can't...
Cool.
Was that the same game, just a remake?
Do you want to...
Was it a different game?
Do you want to say your last sentence again? We just lost you there.
Yeah.
Was Perfect Dark Zero a remaster of the N64, or was it a new game?
Perfect Dark... was a... Actually, I'm not going to answer because I don't want to add to my time.
Okay. I can't remember. I remember liking Perfect Dark Zero. If that was the remake of Perfect Dark, then cool, that game was good.
I can fill in if you like.
Go on then.
For the record, Perfect Dark Zero was a prequel to the original Perfect Dark.
Ah, right, okay. I've never played Perfect Dark, and I've just talked for like 2 minutes about nothing, so carry on.
Well played, that man.
So Bioshock, I adored Bioshock back in the day, but I think it's dated pretty poorly these days, because if you look at the morality system and the fact that you only had to kill one little sister and you got the bad ending, and you had to save all the little sisters to get the good ending, and there's the morality system back then was pretty much insular to that one. So, you know, each time you could choose whether to do one thing or the other. And I think that was pretty insular. And what the impression it gave at the time was that was a great morality decision. And I think since then we've moved on so far past that, where we've got, you know, Telltale's games where you can end up with 30 different endings to something. You know, I think that's dated quite badly in that terms. But gameplay wise, I think it's fantastic. And I don't think it's aged very much at all. I think it's one of the most intelligent shooters I've played in years. And then there's 13. What a fucking game that was.
Yeah.
Like that was such a good game. I mean, you know, that was probably David Duchovny's Oscar winning moment. If they could have given him Oscar for a game performance. I mean, that performance wasn't dialed in. You know, that wasn't like, I'm getting a paycheck here. This was David Duchovny at his prime, really, really giving it some for a game. You know, I was impressed with that game. So I guess we've got to try and decide on one. And, you know, I don't know how everyone else is feeling. I look at these and I think Halo 3 is brilliant for some people. Not necessarily me.
Well, I'll take Halo 3 out straight away, to be fair.
Damn, fair son.
Brutal. Got to be brutal.
Okay, I'd just like it to be known that Paul does not speak on the behalf of anybody else but himself. Perfect Dark, then. I can't remember playing it. Obviously, anybody else got any strong feelings on Perfect Dark?
No, I don't play it really. So,
okay, BioShock.
Well, I put that through straight away.
Right.
I have no feelings to it, either. To be fair.
Okay, because what we're left here is we're left with BioShock or 13. Now, let's just mention the Metacritic cricket.
Yeah,
the Metacritic.
BioShock got a Metacritic of 94, and 13 got a Metacritic score of 72.
Yeah, but the reviewers back then, in like, well, they were stupid. So
it's also, you know, don't forget, this is about this is Ross. Rossi's kind of perfect game, if you like. So regardless, if it got 5 out of 100.
Oh, no, if it got 5, it wouldn't be going through.
No, but if Ross was loving it, then that's why he could put it in, you know what I mean?
So, good point, Paul. Good point.
I think it happens sometimes. No, that doesn't. Sometimes.
Right, so I out of the two, I think we should put through BioShock. But I also would like it known that I, you know, if it was a preference thing, I would put through 13.
Well, it's two votes for BioShock, and then you could be the deciding vote, isn't it, really? So I guess it could be 2 for 13, 2 for BioShock. What are you going for, Ross? What one do you want to go through?
Well, it's not up to me, is it?
What did you pick one? Well, I don't know. So I'll go for BioShock. I haven't played 13, so I'll have no opinion.
Right, BioShock it is, then.
Yeah, my vote is null and void.
Yes.
Just for the record, I would have gone for 13, but...
That's unfortunate.
Yeah. It's unlucky for some.
All right, then. Okay, let's crack on with the knowledge, Mr. Sean Davies.
Okay.
And what is your first game?
Duke Nukem 3D, the 20th anniversary edition.
Damn, son. Right, let me just get a stopwatch going. And after 3, 1... 2, 3.
Okay, so I have owned Duke Nukem 3D 6 times in the past 20 years. I've owned it on PC, PlayStation, N64, Vita, Sega Saturn, and now the PlayStation 4 with a 20th anniversary edition. I used to appreciate this game because I was an idiot teenager who liked boobs and he liked shooting pigs in the face, and I liked the pop culture references. But over time, after I've played this on the PlayStation 3 and the Vita, and in my later years, I've started to appreciate this game in an entirely different way. So it's an incredibly well-designed game. It's kind of timeless design too, because the levels are sprawling. They have multiple ways to get around. They've got vents and teleporters, and you can blow up walls. And it's an expansive game where you can play a level twice, never play it the same way twice, if you don't want to. And the game is always trying to kill you. So it doesn't make you feel like a badass by putting you in set pieces where you're flying down zipline, shooting people or something. It just constantly puts you in positions where you are completely against the odds, where it's like shrinking you down and putting you in a room full of people that could stamp on you. Or they put pigs with like round corners, or they put bosses in rooms with no weapons. It's just a game that really wants to kill you. And when you do succeed at that game, it means that you've done good. It has proper boss battles too. It's in arenas with weapons, and the bosses are really hard to kill. So the 20th anniversary is the best version because it has proper walls that aren't just stretched pixels that can make you go all kind of weird. It has the reverse time that was in the Megaton edition, and it has a special 5th episode that was done by the designers of the original game, Alan Bloom III, and the level lord himself, Richard Gray. Lee Jackson did a new score for this, and then John St. John returned to voice Duke. And I'm just going to leave it on this line. In the new 5th episode, he says the words, "I do shit." Shit.
Oh, no.
Not again.
It's your fault for being the knowledge.
Yeah.
That was one word over. That's not fair.
You're too knowledgeable.
Right.
It's just got awkward.
Okay, we got it at 2 minutes 0.15 seconds. Do we let it go?
No, I think I'm allowed that.
All right, okay. Okay, I'm saying that's okay. Sean, you're lucky.
Thank
Stu,
you.
Paul, happy with that?
Yeah, I think he was finished. You know, he'd finished his rundown and speech. He was just kind of, you know, he put himself over by bringing in a quote to the party. You know, so
yeah. Just like all those essays I used to write.
A yellow card, Sean. It's a yellow card, mate.
Yeah.
Okay, yellow card.
Okay.
That means you're not allowed to mention the word Duke Nukem or 3D.
And when we talk about it, you have to be completely silent.
Okay.
Okay, so your next game.
Game two is Wolfenstein The New Order.
Nice. Okay. One, two, three.
This game got a Metacritic score of 79. And that is an absolute crime. Because I don't know a single person that has played this game and gone, wow, this game is actually the fucking nuts. Apart from a couple of duff stealth missions, Wolfenstein is brilliant. It's got a proper old school feel to it, but it's got a lot of modern day sensibilities about it. So it's got hidden rooms, but it's also got Nazi mechs. It's got an enjoyable story. It passes the Bletchley Wallace test several times. It looks incredible. It goes to some brilliant locations. So you start in the trenches around a castle, then you go into the castle, then you end up in a hospital, then you go to a prison, then you go to huge Nazi installations, and then the moon. You know, what more can you ask for? It's fluid gunplay mechanics I have ever experienced, and it has got some of the most meatiest guns too. The shotguns in this game, while dual wielding, is fucking amazing. It's got some really smart design, so sometimes it takes all the weapons off you and asks you to just take out massive mechs without weapons, so having to be smart about how you take them down. And for me, it's one of the most underappreciated gems of this generation and one of the best shooters I have ever played. Done.
121.
That's better.
That's more like it.
Poignant.
Indeed. Right. Game number three.
Unreal Tournament.
Oh, man.
Ooh,
okay. Cool. One, two, three.
So every other game that we're probably going to talk about today is going to borrow something from Unreal Tournament, from Quake, or from Doom. And Unreal Tournament took Quake and a lot from Doom and made it just 10 times better. So Unreal Tournament, for its time, was by far the best first-person shooter that had ever been released. It combined all of the games that came before it into an amazing package. It wasn't overtly original, and was originally planned as an expansion for Unreal, but it took what Quake started and it just took it to the next generation. So everything about this game was terrific. You think about two worlds, the multiplayer map, the level design, the weaponry, and how it had dual modes, like the bouncing blades from the Ripper, the game modes, which most people know nowadays, just standard game modes, which everyone takes for granted, started with Quake and then Unreal Tournaments, where they stepped it up a gear. The speed of play, which was unprecedented at the time, and the balance for the gameplay, which was also pretty unprecedented. You know, you always had these balancing issues, but Unreal Tournament nailed that. And then you had auto difficulty changing bots. So if you didn't have a full multiplayer map, they would fill with bots, and the bots would change depending on how good you were playing. So if you were kicking ass, the bots would ease off a bit and give your opposition a bit of chance. Everything about Unreal Tournament was groundbreaking in 1999. But it didn't go overly well with critics. It didn't have a plot. So, you know, Eurogamer were like, it didn't have a plot. And who give a shit? Because this game was so fucking good that we didn't need one. It got 12 Game of the Year awards from the biggest outlets at the time. It got CVG, GameSpot, CNET. Everybody gave it Game of the Year or nominated for it. And it's just one of those games that took competitive multiplayer to the next level, did more than Halo, Counter-Strike, Call of Duty, any of those games ever did for competitive multiplayer. Unreal Tournament did it first. And that's why it's one of the first versions. Best
versions.
Oh, no!
Doing this on purpose.
Fuck's sake. Yes. I'd finished anyway. I didn't say a word over the 2 minutes.
You said best first-person shooters, and you were going to finish that. with something. Yeah. So I can't. That was 201.
Oh,
sorry, Brad.
Fine.
That's my choice as well.
Oh. Yeah, I know. Can you not take Duke Nukem off, Ross?
Yeah, take that off instead. Unreal Tournament's too good to be.
Well, I tell you what, I'm just gonna, you know, the last game might sway you anyway. But if it doesn't, then if you want to decide that 2 minutes one is fine, then I wouldn't be too early about that.
2 minutes point, you know, 0.15 is fine, I think. But 201.50, that's nearly 2 minutes and 2 seconds.
Shocking.
Yeah, you know, I'm not gonna be one to argue about whether 2 seconds over is enough to knock a game out or not. I'll leave that in your capable hands by leaving you with steamers like the games they've already picked against Unreal Tournament. I'll leave that in your capable hands.
Okay, well, I hate to do it, Sean, I really do, but I don't think we can include an Unreal now. You know, we have rules here that we must abide by.
I would take off Duke Nukem instead, as a sacrifice.
And you would have done it to me.
I wouldn't.
Well, don't you lost.
I think that's a daft rule.
You're the worst one for it. That's why it's a daft rule, I think.
Yeah, that's very true. Yeah.
Okay. right. Your final game of your three that you're allowed now.
Alien versus Predator.
All right. One, two, three.
So I'm not talking about the terrible 2010 game or the 1993 SNES game. I'm talking about the 1999 release from Rebellion Games. You play as an alien, a predator, or a marine, and each had their own campaign and strengths and weaknesses. So the alien had a fisheye view to represent the way that they could see. It had no weapons, but it could crawl all over the ceilings and walls. And you could see through them to see living beings, but you couldn't see androids, so they were your weakness. The Predator used many of the visual filters you see in the films, as well as most of the weaponry. And the Marine had the auto cannons and the motion tracker and the flamethrowers, and he was just a badass that kept shouting. So while each of these had their strengths, they each had their weaknesses, and when they were put together in a multiplayer map, all hell broke loose, and it was such an enjoyable game to play because you literally had a Predator scoping out a human and then being eaten by an alien who was then shot by the Marine, and then it just fucking went mad, and it was such a brilliant game because it was so well balanced. And it also had a level of authenticity and atmosphere, melding both the franchises into something that we didn't see again until Alien Isolation. And it's one of my favourite first-person shooter games. I know it wasn't perfect, but it was bloody brilliant for me, and I really enjoyed it, and I wasn't the only one. So that's my pitch.
Damn, that's quick.
123.
Wow.
You go from one extreme to the other.
I've given you 43 seconds to play with.
Oh, come on.
I'll let you decide.
It's like a time bank, isn't it?
Yeah. Right. We're not taking an aggregate here, you know.
Okay.
Okay. I'll go first on this one because I have a big issue. And that...
What about the game zone?
No. Yeah, I was going to say. Yeah.
Hey! Boom. Paul Connett talking to me about big issues. Duke Nukem 3D is the only one that I've played.
Whoops.
So, it's not going anywhere.
Oh, who made you kind of like Lord of the Manor all of a sudden?
I think you
did. We all did. Yeah, we all did.
Oh, damn it.
I was playing Duke Nukem 3D recently. I was playing the new remastered that's out on PS4. It is a ton of fun. It is rubbish, but it's rubbish in a really fun, superb kind of way. I enjoy the shooting mechanics, if you can even call it that. It's fun to run around the cinema and just cause havoc and like end up in the toilets and shoot pigs and stuff that are on the toilet. That's always fun. It's daft and stupid, and I think it's earned its right in history, you know. And so, out of those four, Duke Nukem 3D for me is greatest game in the history of Sean's choices. Stu?
Okay. Duke Nukem 3D is brilliant. I absolutely love it. Thing that I enjoy most about it is the space bar. And used to use that, if I remember rightly, to start him using items. So using the toilet and looking in the mirror, you know, cueing him going, damn, I'm looking good. All the way to shaking some money at the pole dancers.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, great game. Like you say, utterly ridiculous. It's, you know, if you look at the shooter aspect of it, it's a pretty crap game. But everything else just kind of overwrites all of that. I mean, you know, you're shooting pig cops. What more do you want in a game? Wolfenstein, I never played a game in the series, even down to the newest ones, so I can't really pass judgment on that. Moving over Unreal Tournament to Alien vs. Predator, I vaguely remember playing the 1999 game. And yeah, as Sean said, it's just absolute carnage. Plus, it's two brilliant franchises amalgamated into one video game. And, you know, anything that you start talking about the Predators and things like that, you immediately go back to, you know, the film Predator with Arnie. And, you know, it's just, you know, you could be there all night thinking of different Predator scenes and different alien scenes, and being able to play as either or and a Colonial Marine in a video game is just fantastic. It's just a shame that Aliens Colonial Marines bombed so badly. I think that would have been a great sort of spiritual successor to the Alien versus Predator franchise. But I think out of those, my choice has to go with Duke Nukem purely for its ridiculousness.
Okay, and it's better than Toe Jam and Earl, isn't it?
I'm not going to make any comment on that at all.
Paulie?
Okay, so Duke Nukem 3D, I really enjoyed that for the same reasons Sean did, with the pop culture references and, you know, the funny quips and quotes the guy had. You know, it was very entertaining to play. It wasn't the greatest shooter ever, which I kind of makes me think I can't really choose it, because it wasn't the greatest shooter, but it was a lot of fun to play. Wolfenstein, never played it. I played the original, and I was bored to hell. I hate maze games, so I just didn't really get into that at all. So now I'm gutted that Unreal Tournament got ejected, because I love that game so much. It was the most fun I've had at work ever, over a LAN network. So, you know, I'm gutted. Yeah, it was great. Loved it. It was absolute chaos. Much better than the one you might have found on the older Atari Jaguar, if you can remember that damn thing. So that was great. I loved that. It was nice to play the alien, and the fact that they each had their own powers and weaknesses. It was just perfectly balanced, as Sean said, and it was a lot of fun to play. And it's a shame. It's actually a crying shame. There's not been an update or a sequel or proper sequel to it, because this day and age of online, everything's online. That'd be perfect. It's all game for that. So I think I'm going to have to put through Unreal Tournament.
But you can't.
But you can't.
But I'm going to.
You can't.
Oh, you slags. all right, Alien vs. Predator. It's got to be.
All right, so that leaves us with Duke Nukem and Alien vs. Predator. Do you have any special feelings towards either of them, Stu?
I would have to put Duke Nukem, I think, for me. That's definitely the one for me out of the two. I love both games, but I think for pure fun factor in the shooter, Duke Nukem.
Just by default, I need to put Duke Nukem through, because I've not played the others. And also, it's a lot of fun.
I would like to say, if Sean hadn't gone over time, Unreal Tournament would be moseying on into the next round.
I cannot believe that we're not counting Unreal Tournament for 2 seconds.
Nor can I, Sean, actually. Nor can I, to be fair.
In fairness, rules is rules.
in it.
Yeah, rules are there to be broken, in it.
Wow.
Okay.
One of the best open world games ever is Batman Arkham City. And we ejected that last time because of Sean again.
didn't we lose one of yours as well, Ross? One of he your did. Ones that would have got through as well.
Yeah, you lost.
There's a moral to this story somewhere.
Yeah, don't speak.
I will not stop doing it until I get rid of the rule. I'm just saying. next time, every one of them is going over 2 minutes, so be prepared.
Right, so two for Duke Nukem. Paul, are you happy with Duke Nukem to go through?
Yeah, I guess so. I don't have much choice, do I, really? I do like the game, so, yeah, but I'd rather a real tournament go through. So, you know.
Okay. So, in a field of Wolfenstein, Unreal, and Alien vs. Predator, Duke Nukem 3D is the choice. I like that. Okay, Mr. Stuart Shortland.
Bonjour.
What is your first game?
Call of Duty Modern Warfare.
Oh, okay. You have 2 minutes, and I'm going to stress again, you have 2 minutes.
2 minutes, right? Not okay. 2 minutes and one.
2 minutes and 0.15 seconds.
Yeah.
Okay, 1, 2, 3.
So Call of Duty for me was the epitome of first-person shooters, and I know that there is another couple of members on the podcast that will probably agree with me to some respects. And it's just the way it handles warfare for me. From the characters, you know, Soap, he's just a cool dude. There's nothing else about it. You know, he's getting dropped onto a ship in the middle of the ocean in the first mission, and he's smoking a cigar, and he's just like, yeah, whatever. I'm just going to go down there. I'm going to kill loads of people, and I'm going to get picked up. All hell breaks loose, but that's not, you know, that's the whole point of the game. For me, though, the big thing for Modern Warfare was the multiplayer side of things. I lost days into the multiplayer, and it was the start of the first-person shooters as we know them today, but as we kind of know them today. It enabled people to create classes, take on your friends, shoot them in the face, shoot them in the back of the head. And it was just great fun, from the maps design to everything else. And it was just, I'm lost for words by the actual game itself, because it is just, it's perfect in every single way. And I think I'll just leave it there. You know, Call of Duty Modern Warfare is, for me, the best shooter.
1:28. Right, you said that now, so do you want to just, like, not bother with the other three, or...?
Well, you know, I'm going to throw them out there for you.
Okay.
Which is why I've gone for the other three, you see.
Sure. Game number two.
GoldenEye, 007, in particular.
Okay, let's do it. One.
Let's not do that again.
Two. Three.
So this is the N64 version, not the later versions that got released on the Xbox 360 and things like that. And this was for me the first sort of couch multiplayer games that I started playing. You know, you're getting your friends around, you're plugging all your controllers to the N64, you make a unwritten rule that nobody is to be Odd Job because he is just way too short to fire in the face. And everybody ends up picking him, and you end up playing a hats only match. And it's, you know, the story, I never can't remember much about the story, but it was just pure James Bond-ness, you know, gadgets, kills, everything that you could want in a James Bond, game. Obviously, Ross has always mentioned its spiritual successor by Rare, Perfect Dark. It was kind of just good to play. It was well designed. It was solid. You know, you could run around in free roaming 3D levels, doing different objectives, killing people, going to different places, you know, meeting with other NPCs, hostage rescue missions. It was just good. And by the simple fact that it was on the N64, and once again on what I considered to be one of the best controllers that you could have for a shooter. I mean, it was a freaking gun handle, for crying out loud. If you are ever going to play a GoldenEye game, buy an N64 and play the original. Don't play any of the latest reimaginings, because they're just absolute shite. End off.
Told.
1:40 Good, good. All right, number three.
This is the curveball of my choices, which is going to be a regular occurrence. Clive Barker's Undying.
Well, this should be fun. One.
not really.
Two, three.
So it's a first-person shooter survival horror made by EA, and I played it on the PC back, when was it, years ago. I think it got released in like 2001. And it was just freaky is the only thing that I could explain. Basically, it was all about cult happenings and things that were going on. And from what I remember playing, it scared the shit out of me. Bearing in mind, in 2001, I wasn't very old. I'm not going to tell you how old I was, but I wasn't very old. You essentially find a rock, and this rock that you wield at certain points, these stones, they show out the scariness of stuff. So you'll be 1 minute looking at a corridor, and then the next minute you'll bring out this rock, and there'll be like blood on the walls and stuff flying at you. And it was just absolutely freaky. There probably won't be many people that have played it, and for that reason, it probably won't go through. But I just remember it just scaring the crap out of me, and that's the only reason why I think it should go through, the pure chills and scares, and that's why I can't play scary games anymore.
1:15
So it was a quick one.
I hear that's what you're known for. And finally...
Not called quick draw for nothing.
And finally,
Rainbow Six Siege.
All right, 1, 2, 3
So another, obviously, there's a first-person tactical shooter. You take teams of five on fives, and you go out onto the maps and you take on, obviously, other people. There's no story mode per se. There's a series of terrorist hunt missions and operations which see you sort of carry out, you know, hostage rescues and bomb disarmaments, but the thing I like about it is the tactical side of things. You choose a character at the start of each round, but you can't have more than one of those characters, so you get used to a certain character. You take a certain character with certain skills into the game, and you have to work as a team. If you go and join a random room of four other people, you are not going to win against a team that are well-organized and know what they're doing. The thing that I always found quite amazing with this game is that if I was basically protecting a hostage and shot people as they came through a door, apparently I'm a camper, but the whole point of this game is to camp. The whole point is just purely to camp, to protect your objectives, and that's lost in a lot of first-person shooters these days. You know, you play Domination on Call of Duties and people are running around killing people rather than taking the objectives. This is purely objective-based. Yes, you can kill all the other opponents and win the round that way, but you get more points for doing the objective, and that is why Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six is one of the best shooters out there, purely because it's tactical and you are forced to play the objective.
1:35 Good work, Stu.
Thank you very much.
Bravo. Okay. Sean, do you want to go first?
Yeah. I hate you, Stu.
I know. I'm sorry, Sean.
I can't believe you picked Modern Warfare and GoldenEye.
You could have picked them. You could have picked them.
I could have done, but I went with Unreal Tournament, but, you know, I messed that up, so... so Modern Warfare is for me the best Call of Duty game. I recently made a video about why I love it so much, and if you want to know all about that, you can visit our channel at I'm not going to tell you the channel name, but yeah, that game is purely brilliant. It's constantly overpowers the enemy. You make you feel very strong, very very camaraderie, and I think it's a brilliant military shooter. GoldenEye, possibly the best local co-op game, local multiplayer game ever created. It's an absolute blast. And in my house, we had a rule: whoever picked our job first was our job. So that was the rule in my house. We didn't have to ban him. He was just good. And that worked for me because I wasn't fast, but I also shoot for the knee. So That wasn't too bad there. While you were talking, I googled Clive Barker's Undying because I couldn't remember it, and that's unusual. So I googled these and then realised that I had played it, and it had a weird flashback, and remembered how scary that game was. But I also remember it being pretty terrible.
Oh yeah, it was terrible, but it was scary.
Yeah, yeah. I think it was scary for the 8-year-old me. So I can't. It's no Outlast. So
I just got chills.
Yeah, fair enough. Rainbow Six Siege, I've only played one of the 3 weekends, and I can say I enjoyed it. I can see where you're coming from. It definitely built up tension, which you don't get on multiplayer shooters very often anymore. You don't have to creep around. You just run and shoot. And in this, you're like shooting holes in walls to see if you can see the enemy, and you can send in your bot, your remote control bot, to see where the enemies are. I can see why you picked that game, and I agree with you, it is a very good shooter. But it's so hard to course you. I can't believe you put like two of my, like, you know, Modern Warfare and GoldenEye are brilliant games, and I couldn't choose between them.
Paul.
Oh man. Well, Call of Duty, never really been a fan of any of these kind of Call of Duty Battlefield games, but Modern Warfare, I do remember really enjoying it and being blown away by how it makes you feel so sort of, you know, right fucking stuck in the middle of a shitstorm. You think, what the fuck? And it's great, and, you know, you just think, Jesus Christ, if this is like a game, what's it like in real life? Do you know what I mean? You think, fuck me, excuse my French. I enjoyed playing it. It was good. It's a very good. I didn't really play the multiplayer side so much, but as a single player game, I thought it was amazing. GoldenEye, now this is probably one of my favorite all time local multiplayer games. I've had so much fun with this game. Even with my non-gamer friends, we've all got bundled around and had a quick game of GoldenEye, and I think that's a testament to how good it actually was and how much fun it was and how accessible it was. It was like, if Fisher Price made a shoot 'em up, it would be this. It was that simple, you know what I mean? My first shoot 'em up. It was fantastic. Never played Clive Barker's Undying, so I can't really comment on that. And Rainbow Six Siege. Now, I was really looking forward to this because I'm a big fan of Rainbow Six games. But I didn't really enjoy this one much. Now, you hit on the point there when he's talking about it, Stuart, is that if you just join a random game, you are absolutely fucked. It is the biggest pile of shit you'll ever see. Because people are running around, they want to shoot things, they're trying to make Call of Duty in this kind of more of a tactical stealth game. It's not working. But if you've got a team, you all chat to each other and make them tactics, and it's absolutely amazing. But unless you have that team, which is hard to come by unless you've got 5 gamer mates, it's actually just really, really bad. So just for the sheer amount of time I played it, I'm going to have to go for GoldenEye as my choice.
Right. I'm with Sean. This is very difficult. Undying, I've not played. Rainbow Six, I played the beta, I think, possibly one of the 3 weekends. I think me and Sean may have played it together, actually. It was fine, but I didn't really want to buy it, so it's not for me. But Call of Modern Warfare and GoldenEye, Jesus, it's the holy grail of first person shooters is both of those games. Modern Warfare is the best Call of Duty. There's no getting around that. GoldenEye is my childhood, much like Zelda was on the last episode. Oh God, man, I don't know. If you know. Someone had a gun to my head, like James Bond or something. God. I think I'd have to put through Modern Warfare, but how do you not put through GoldenEye?
What did you go for, Sean?
Sean has a picture.
Oh. Sneak.
What did you go for, Paul? You went for GoldenEye.
I've GoldenEye, yeah.
Currently, it's 1-1 for which game goes through. So, unfortunately, Sean,
pressure.
Yeah, yeah.
Put them both through. Put them both through and don't give Paul a go.
Oh, thank you. That just sums my life up, doesn't it? Thank you.
Stop trying to break the rules, Sean.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a punk.
You mean proper rebellious tonight.
I know, I'm sorry. Sorry, sir. Sorry.
Fucking will be, bitch.
I've played Modern Warfare recently, and that game, you know, the remaster, is still brilliant. I've not played GoldenEye recently. I played the remastered version. What was it? GoldenEye Legends or something.
Oh, God.
Yeah. I didn't enjoy that.
No.
Is that because the game is so now dated? I don't know. I don't know. I'm gonna have to say, how can you put through Modern Warfare over GoldenEye? But then, how can you put through GoldenEye over Modern Warfare?
This is obvious. This is the conundrum we currently find ourselves in.
Yeah, and the power is in your hands.
It's up to you, Jamie.
Okay. Well, why, Stuart, could you not talk for 2 minutes and just take one of these out and make everything really easy for us? Modern Warfare. Modern Warfare.
Oh, no.
Whoa.
Fair.
Damn.
Oh, shit, son.
He gone done it. Anyway, yeah. I'll stop being racist for a minute. Okay. So, Call of Duty Modern Warfare it is. Sorry, Rare, you're not doing well tonight. It's okay, our final competitor, Mr. Paul Collett. Oh,
God! I don't like first-person shooters. This is really hard, so you have to bear with me. Look, I don't like them. I'm really, really bad at them, so I'll just die, spawn, die, repeat. That's all I do, and it just does my head in, so...
I love you so much, man. I love you so much. Right, your first game.
Okay, so I'm going to go for Destiny.
Destiny, okay. Let me just set up a timer. I was on Instagram checking out Lucy Collett's new picture. I'm sorry. Right. 1, 2, 3.
So, Destiny. I know Halo 3 now I didn't like so much, but Destiny was made such a big deal, so I had to get involved. And when I first started playing it, I was like, oh, this is just, you know, another shooter, blah, blah, blah. But then you kind of realise the thing that really got me hooked on Destiny was originally was the kind of concept artwork that Bungie released, and it was just like this beautiful, almost 70s-esque science fiction, and it was beautiful, so I thought, Joe, I'm going to give it a go. And I'm glad I did, because it is one of the most satisfying shooters I have ever played. It's just that the shooting mechanics are absolute just perfection. I don't think it can be bettered. There's just some awesome satisfaction when you're just reloading your gun and you're shooting and you get a headshot. It just feels right. It's just amazing. The grinding is not for everybody. It does great after a while, but it is nice to finally get those legendary bits of weapon and those exotics and so on. And you see yourself sort of leveling up, and levels you found so hard previously are actually a breeze because you're leveling up. It just all happens so seamlessly. It's just fantastic. And obviously, you can do the strikes or so on, which put you in a team of three random people, or you could do it with people you know. But the good thing is, even if you hook up with like three different people you don't know, you still get some camaraderie going on, because, you know, you die and get revived, and there's just a big kind of overwhelming odds against you. So, you know, it's a big team spirit, even if you don't know these people or even talk to them. So Destiny was fantastic. You know, it looks amazing. The game, the shoot, it's basically the shooting mechanics is what won it over for me, because it was... is just so satisfying, and that is why Destiny has to go through.
1:42.
Oh, God, that's close. Ooh, for me.
That's close. That's close. Okay. Not bad then, man. Well done.
Thanks, man.
Game number two.
Rainbow Six Vegas.
Oh, here we go then, Governor. One.
Okay, so Rainbow
two.
Six
Wait, hold up. Okay.
I'll get minus seconds for that.
No, you're all right. Don't worry. Oh. Okay.
Don't tempt him.
1, 2, 3.
Okay, so Rainbow Six Vegas. This game was great, and it's for one reason only, and that's because it had a third-person cover system. Now, anyone who plays first-person shooters knows that if you're getting shot at by a fuck ton of robots and shit, you can't. You just have to duck behind a wall, and that's all you can. If you peek up and you get shot in the face, it's no good. It's rubbish. But Rainbow Six Vegas had this great mechanic where you go into cover and it switches to third person, where you can see like the landscape around you, and you can duck out of cover, quickly snipe someone, duck back in. And as soon as you left the cover, it seamlessly went back into the first person mode. And that was just fantastic. I think every shooter should have that option, at least an option to turn on or off, because it does help a lot when you're trying to be more tactical with your shooting. So that was a great mechanic that's been woefully underused in all shoot 'em ups, in my opinion. And also, it is a great kind of multiplayer as well. So if you and your friends are storming a building and stuff, you can each take your own little path. You know, one guy can open the door, flashbang. The other guy can open the door and then start shooting while they're confused. And it was great. It's like, you know, cover me, I'm going in, flank me, you know, that kind of thing. It's a proper tactical shooter. And it worked much more than it did in Siege, simply because of the fact it was a lot simpler. You know, you had various weapons like flashbangs and stun grenades, but it didn't have like wall building things and robots and whatnot. It was just a more pure, simple game. And especially that third person cover system, it was just fantastic. And I think that should be in every game from now on. So make it happen, you game people. There you go.
133. Ooh. Well done, Paul.
Thank you.
Bravo, it's a jolly good show. Okay, game number three.
Now, game number three is Bioshock Infinite.
All right, one, two, three.
Now, Bioshock, as previously mentioned, the shooting, maybe it has that little bit, maybe it hasn't, that's up to opinion. But the thing that hooked me on this game, and I can't stress how utterly fantastic it was the intro to Infinite, where you climb up a lighthouse, and you press a button and a kind of big booming noise happened and the sky lit up, and then this big floating city of Columbus appeared and you shot up and you floated down while the American, or a weird version of the American anthem was playing. It was just beautiful. It just almost brought tears to my eye in a really weird way. But that aside, as soon as you land, you get outside of the cabin a bit, you land in, you're welcome to Columbus, which is a city in the sky, and it's just the most imaginative level design I've ever seen. It's just like floating city. It looks incredible. The guns and the weapons, the shooting, it's up for debate, but they had some awesome powers you could use and level up, and that one made up for it. And then you've got the sky hook where you can hook onto the rails and fly around all the different sort of floating islands. Great enemies, great story, great characters. It was just a really beautiful game. It just triggered something in my imagination that made me just want to keep on playing and playing and playing. I forgot about the shooting side of it more, and I just focused on the story and the world it was based in, because it was just that good. And that is why that should be the great shooter ever.
1:30. There you go.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Very good. Okay, and your final game?
Half-Life 2.
Half-Life 2. Okay, one, two, three.
Okay, so I'm going to struggle on this because it's been a well long time since I played it. All I remember is it being great, a great story, and it had some awesome new gaming features that hadn't been sort of used before, like the gravity gun and so on. And I don't really remember much about it, but I remember enjoying it so much that it has to go into this list. And that's all I can say about it, really. It was such a long time ago since I played it, but I remember it being awesome, so it has to, you know.
Fair enough. Right. Okay. 23 seconds.
Yay.
And before you are short, you can't change some of that time for Unreal Tournament.
Well, yes, you can, actually.
No, we can't.
Time. Stu, do you want to go first on this one?
Yeah, why not? Destiny. I got Destiny on release, and I thought it was going to be, as Paul, I thought it was going to be the greatest shooter in the whole wide world. Unfortunately for me, I got to the point where I'd finished all of the main sort of story missions and things like that, and then I am not a grinding kind of gamer. And for me, it's...
That is really weird, sorry.
Yeah,
gamer. It's quite funny.
Maybe I loitered too long on the gamer.
I'm not a grinder gamer.
Yeah.
I'm a completely grinder yet.
No, yeah. I'm working through though. But yeah, just the whole grinding aspect of the game just kind of irritated me slightly. You know, I spent hours in front of that cave where you'd get the endless stream of enemies coming out just to get these little, you know, just to get the, what were the little orbs called? The I can't even, that's the one, the engrams, and, you know, trying to get the rare ones to spawn and things like that. And whilst, yes, it was a great, you know, it was a good shooter and the story was good, I haven't gone back to see any of the DLC, and I'm sure they've expanded on it greatly. Is it the greatest shooter out of the list? It quite possibly could be out of the list here. Rainbow Six Vegas is a Rainbow Six game, and it was great fun. And like Paul said, the element where you go behind cover and then it would change to a third person was good. I have issues with third person games on multiplayer and things like that, because I think it just makes it a little bit too easy to see where people are coming from. But it is a great sort of a great system to use as such. BioShock Infinite, I played through a little bit of it, didn't finish it for one reason or another. And from what I remember, you know, it was great fun. Using the sky hooks and stuff to get around was great fun. The floating cities or whatever they were great. And then Half-Life 2, the same as Paul. I remember it being great, but don't really remember too much about it. Unfortunately, I think if I had to take a pick out of the four games, even though I just absolutely slated it, I'd probably have to put Destiny through, purely on where it started and where it's come from, and the fact that, you know, it is actually quite fun and a good, the shooting in it is great, and the fact that you get to ride around on sort of hover bikes.
Sparrows, man. They're called sparrows.
Fine. I love Destiny. You know how much I love Destiny, but we play Destiny together when we get a chance.
Love it.
And we have a lot of fun going in doing strikes and things. Again, I bought it at launch and I had a wonderful time with it. It lost me for a little while. I didn't really come back into it until The Taken King got released. And then I was so far behind that I kind of lost myself a bit. But I jumped back in again a few months ago and I got myself up to the highest level. And I realized, damn, this is actually just really, really fucking fun. And there's a lot to enjoy. You know, Ghost is always fun to have around. Peter Dinklage or Nolan North, whichever one you prefer. You get to, you know, be able to upgrade weapons, and the tower's always fun. I just really enjoy Destiny a lot, and I think it's earned its right. I mean, it's still selling by the bucket load, and it's still got a massive player base. It's obviously thanks to Bungie and their constant updates and new content, and it's a wonderful world to explore. And so Destiny is a great game. Rainbow Six Vegas, I've not played. BioShock Infinite, I love, absolutely adore. It doesn't seem to have a huge following anymore. People seem to have dismissed it somewhat. But I really enjoyed it. I completely agree with Paul. I remember that first moment you go out the lighthouse and, you know, you see Columbia for the first time, and it's an incredible moment. And that does stay with you. So I think it's a great game in its own right, if it's not being compared to the previous BioShocks. And Half-Life 2 is Half-Life 2. I mean, it's one of the greatest first-person shooters. It's one of the greatest games of all time, full stop. And that's why there's such an outcry for more. And like the orange box and everything that came with that, it's a magnificent experience. And so I think I'd put through Half-Life 2 out of all that lot. But there's a great selection there, Paul. Bravo. So.
Thanks, pal.
Sean?
I thought Stew was bad with Modern Warfare and GoldenEye, but Paul has really put the cat among the pigeons. Half-Life 2 has to go through. I'm just going to say that, because that is the best game out of anything that we've said so far. And I know you can't remember much about it, Paul, but I can remember plain as day walking through that village being scared out of me. There's some things that stick with you, and Half-Life 2 is one of those games. And you know that I wanted that in my time. Gutted that you wrote it down first. Destiny is one of these games I have a really love-hate relationship with, because when I played, I hated. And then when I deleted it off my hard drive, like a week later, I'm like, I really want to play some Destiny. And I don't know why the fuck that is. But I think I enjoyed the RPG aspects more than I do the shooter aspects. But I agree with you, it is a very good shooter. And it really pains me to say that, I'll be honest. I've even written articles about how much I hate Destiny. And I have to admit, I have to admit it is a good game. Rainbow Six Vegas, that was a brilliant game. I really loved it. Rainbow Six, and it's one of those games that kind of I completely forget about, and then you just mention it and I'm like, oh yeah, Rose Tinted Glasses, this game was great. And I only ever played it online once, and that was with you, and this was before I knew you were a Cockney. And that was a fun time on the mic. That was, yeah, that was good times.
Yeah, just a bit.
BioShock Infinite, you mentioned coming up to the floating city and the moments where you see it all there in the clouds, and that is for me the best moment of that game, because it all goes downhill for me after that. Oh. I think it becomes repetitive very quickly. You know, the sky hooks, the people just popping up from random places just to shoot you, and then the storyline kind of starts to waver off, and sure, it pulls it all together in the end, but there's so much filler in that game that it's just completely unnecessary. And yeah, I don't get it. I don't get on with BioShock Infinite. And then Half-Life 2. Yeah, it's amazing. That's the game that needs to go through for me.
All right, so we have two for Half-Life 2. We have one for Destiny. Stu, it looks like Half-Life 2 is going through. Are you okay with such things?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, nice selection there, Paul.
Cheers, pal.
Probably the best one out of the lot. Right. Now comes the time where we have to decide which of these four is going out and the final three that we are left with at the end. So I'm going to throw it over to, let's pick one at random, Paul.
Okay, so we've got BioShock, Duke Nukem 3D, Modern Warfare, and Half-Life 2. Now, you know, I'm all for retro games and old games.
What?
And stuff.
Yeah.
I am old.
I know.
But I don't think Duke Nukem can go through as the best first-person shooter of all time. So I'll have to take that one out.
I agree with that. I guess out of the four that we have, Duke Nukem is probably the one that we could lose, which is a shame because it is great fun.
It's a great game, but it's not the greatest shooter, do you know what I mean? It's a lot of fun to play, and you can play with a lot of rose-tinted glasses with that game. But in terms of, like, you know, you've got things like Modern Warfare and Half-Life. How can Duke Nukem 3D beat Half-Life 2? Do you know what I mean?
I agree completely. Mm-hmm. Stu?
I have to agree. You know, if only Sean wasn't so knowledgeable about his games, you know, we could have been talking about a completely different situation. But
them, you Sean, them.
Yeah, I think out of those four games, the weaker of the four is definitely Duke Nukem. Even though I would recommend anybody that hasn't played it to get a version of it somehow, some way, and play it, because it is just ridiculously good fun.
Remastered, now available on PS4. Sean.
Nice. I think we should throw out Unreal Tournament, I'm honest. I look at the list and I see BioShock, and you know, as much as that's aged, it's still not aged as badly as New Nukem 3D has, even though the remaster is actually really good, and anyone who's played it and can play the new 3D mode should absolutely do so, because it looks brilliant. I'm still tits, we're not talking about Unreal Tournament, but yeah, that's okay. And yeah, Duke has to go. I'm sorry, Duke.
Hail to the king. Okay, so that leaves us with BioShock, Call of Duty Modern Warfare, and Half-Life 2 for 1, 2, and 3. So, I'm going to do it a little bit different. this week, this time, because last time we decided on first place straight away, which is just dumb. So we're going to go 3-2-1 this time. So I'm going to throw it over to Stu.
Harrow.
For third place out of these final three.
For me, third place is Bioshock. Without a doubt. Okay.
Any particular reason?
I just think the other two games are better shooters in terms of sort of okay. overall experience, really. No, I mean Modern Warfare. I've got to stick with my choice. As the best one, and Half-Life 2 is just a great game. It's a difficult one because Bioshock in itself is a great story. But you want to be Gordon, don't you? You'd rather be Gordon than the guy in Bioshock. See, I can't even remember the guy's name in Bioshock.
You know what? Can I just say, in terms of names, Bioshock Infinite should go through just for the name of the hero, Booker DeWitt. That's a great name.
It's true.
No, it's not.
I'm not calling my Booker DeWitt.
Are you saying you want to change Half-Life 2 for Bioshock Infinite?
Just because of Booker DeWitt, yeah, totally.
Just because of the name.
Well, Duke Nukem just got thrown out. Duke Nukem.
Yeah. Yeah.
Booker DeWitt or Duke Nukem.
Yeah.
Touché, fair play.
Wind it back in.
Okay, Sean?
Bioshock, third place. Absolutely. The thing with me is that I remember Bioshock really fondly because of that one moment that happens in the game around, you know, two-thirds of the way through that takes pretty much everybody off guard. And it's one of those things that happens once and it only ever happens once. You can only experience that thing once. You can't replay that game again and go, oh, yeah, I didn't see that coming. Mm. And the morality system isn't that great compared to even the second game. And, you know, people say that Bioshock 2 is the weaker of the two set in Rapture. And I prefer to, mostly because of the DLC, which was exceptional. But for me, Bioshock just isn't as good compared to now than the other two.
Okay. Paul?
It's either Bioshock or Modern Warfare, but I'm thinking Bioshock, I think, again, like Infinite, I enjoyed more because of the world it was set in, as opposed to it actually being a very good shooter. I mean, you know, Rapture's just a beautiful place to explore, just like Columbia was, and I think when you're enjoying the surroundings and the levels so much, the weakness of the shooting probably becomes irrelevant in some way, if we're just enjoying the game as it was. But I remember Modern Warfare being an absolutely awesome shooter, even though I kept dying a lot. So, Bioshock for third place.
Okay, Bioshock it is. Bioshock.
What would you have gone for, Roscoe?
I would have gone for Bioshock.
Fair enough.
Bioshock, for sure. You know, it is superb, but it's not Modern Warfare or Half-Life 2. You know what I mean? So, this is probably going to be a bit more difficult. We now have to decide second and first place. And the first person that's going to tackle this is Sean Davies.
Damn, man.
Damn, fool.
You know, of these two, I think about what, you know, Modern Warfare's just had a remaster and I've just replayed it and I've just really enjoyed it all over again. And it's amazing how much of that game you forget when you haven't played it for a while, and how good that game actually was. You know, we talk about it, go, oh yeah, it's the best Call of Duty game. No, it's one of the best first person shooter games ever. But is it better than Half-Life 2? I mean, Half-Life 2 was just phenomenal. You know, this was Valve's masterpiece, wasn't it? This is such a phenomenal game for, you know, not just the plot, but atmosphere, the enemy design, you know, how good it looked then. And, you know, to be fair, given some of the graphics options now, how good it looks now. it's one of those games, you know, it's very hard to pick between the two, given the fact that I've just smashed a pair of rose-tinted glasses on the floor over Modern Warfare Remastered and how good that game is again. But I'm going to have to say Modern Warfare Remastered for second place.
Interesting. I think it should be Half-Life 2. I said earlier that Half-Life 2 is an exceptional game. You know, it's not just an exceptional shooter, it's an exceptional game in its own right. But, you know, like Sean said, I've recently played through Modern Warfare again and blasted it and nearly got the plat, not quite, but I'm getting there. And it's just superb. It's just superb. The mechanics are amazing. The characters are fantastic. You actually give a damn about these characters, which is quite rare in a Call of Duty game. I haven't really cared about any of them since. Except maybe that dude in Black Ops. I can't remember his name. But,
it's called him Barry.
Yeah, it's called him Barry.
Barry from Black Ops.
Barry from Black Ops. but it's been pretty tough to choose between Modern Warfare and Half-Life 2. But I think, personally, because I've been playing it relentlessly and I've enjoyed every second of it, I think Half-Life 2 has to go in second place for me, personally. Opinion only, trademark. Paul?
Oh, I don't know. See, the thing you got to think about is Half-Life 2, back then, was just phenomenal. It was arguably the best game ever at that time. But since that time, things have progressed quite a lot. So it may not necessarily be the best shooting there, but does that matter? Because is it compared to the time you played it, or is it compared to now? I mean, it's hard to, you know, compare it. Because, you know, obviously Modern Warfare has got remasters. You can play it again and you can get a feel for it, but Half-Life 2 doesn't. So... and it's been so long since I played Half-Life 2. But when Sean goes to me, you know, the next episode is going to be first-person shooters, the first one that come to mind was Half-Life 2. So, because that stuck in my mind because it was that good. So I think I'm going to have to put Modern Warfare in second place. Oh, my God.
Finally, Stuart Shortland.
Half-Life 2.
Done.
In second place.
Yeah. Well, I've got to stick to my choice, haven't I?
Sure. Yeah, that makes sense.
So, which then puts us in a predicament like we have had previously.
So that's two for each. Terrific.
It is. Oh, great.
I would say we'll do rock, paper, scissors, but it doesn't really work over a podcast, does it?
No. And we're all on delays and it's just, no, it would never work. Right. Say in a parallel universe, Call of Duty Modern Warfare and Half-Life 2 come out for the latest new console, whatever it is. It's the only two games available to you for the next 10 years because you're stuck on a space station for some reason. You have to choose one of those games to play, and the other one will get destroyed. Sean, which one do you choose?
Now... Here's an important detail for my space station journey. Will there be multiplayer? Will there be other people in the universe for me to play against?
Oh, good question.
Yes, these are the only two games available in the universe.
No, I think it should be single player. Because that makes it even, doesn't it? Because Half-Life doesn't have multiplayer options, does it? Does it?
Don't blame it's not Modern Warfare's fault.
No, but it's the space station's fault, because everyone's been evaporated from Earth. There's no one else exists apart from a little robot that does a gardening. So, it's, you know, it's just doing... it's a little North Star there. I don't know if you've got that, but there you go.
Okay, sure. I'll change it up. You're the last person on Earth. You're the last person, you're the last human being alive. And all you've got to play is Call of Duty Modern Warfare or Half-Life 2. One of them will get destroyed. One of them is the game that you play forever.
Yeah, I would take Half-Life 2. I would take Half-Life 2 because, you know, that game has so many moments. And, you know, just I urge each one of you now, when I'm talking for the next 30 seconds, to Google Half-Life 2 moments or something like that, just to remind yourself of those moments that you've probably forgotten. That's the problem with this, because I recently played the remaster of Modern Warfare, and I know for a fact that that game is absolutely sublime. There wasn't a moment to that game where there were a couple of moments I'd changed, but there's just so much positive about that game, and it's a Call of Duty game. You know, it's like the epitome of stupid shooters, and it's actually a good one. And then you look at Half-Life 2 and you think, this is incredibly intelligent. Not everything's great, you know, but it is an incredibly tense, atmospheric, a game that's going to shit you up for nightmares for weeks to come. And that, to compare the two, just doesn't seem like a rational thought process. You shouldn't be comparing Modern Warfare against Half-Life 2, because Half-Life 2, for me, is just a better game. It's not... But it is like comparing apples and oranges. It's like Half-Life 2 was more atmospheric. It drove that kind of atmosphere, the kind of tension, whereas Modern Warfare drives the, hey, buddy, let's slap each other in the back and kill like 50 guys. Let's do this. Come on. No, go, 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 go. And I'm now having a mental breakdown.
Long overdue, sir.
Okay, I see your point. I see your point. And I get that you can't really compare the two. But if you were on a podcast where the main point of it is comparing games, then
Half-Life 2.
Half-Life 2 as number 2 or number 1?
Number 1.
Okay. Paul?
If I was stuck on this space station and my little robot was watering the flowers, I'd have to... Because I think, like, if you're stuck on a space station, you're going to be bored. And the way to get rid of boredom is being engrossed in a really cool story, which kind of takes you away from the humdrum of being on a space station. And I think Half-Life 2 will give me that, but Modern Warfare won't, in terms of like a single-player campaign. So I'm going to have to go for Half-Life 2 for number one.
Stu!
See, this is a difficult one, because if I'm on my own on a space station, then you want a game that's going to last. And in that, using that as the only kind of argument between which game to pick, you would have to pick Half-Life, because, you know, there's only, no matter how much you like a game, there's only so many times you will go through it and play it the same thing, because it, you know, it is effectively the same game. And I think you can possibly complete Modern Warfare campaign a couple of times, two or three times, and then I think for me it would just get repetitive and boring. It would be different if obviously I had a band of four or five other people there, you know, to private match and things like that. But if we're purely going, I'm the last person in the universe, then yeah, Half-Life 2 I think would have to be at number one, and Modern Warfare would have to slide down gracefully into second place.
All right. I think I'm in agreement. Just
wow, are we all in agreement?
This is it's close. It is close, but I think COD. Yeah. Okay. So at number two is officially Call of Duty Modern Warfare.
And the winner is Unreal Tournament! Yes!
Yes!
So that makes the greatest first-person shooter of all time, decided by Thumb Culture, to be Perfect Dark. Wait, no. Half-Life 2. Well done, fellas.
Mm. Can I just say, for the record, that's two wins on the trot now.
I was just thinking that. I was just thinking, boy. Paul's chosen our two best games so far.
That's what you get for being 40 years old.
Yeah. Well, next episode we've got the game of the year discussion.
Oh, okay.
So that's going to be interesting. So we'll see if you can make it.
Is there a game of the year? I don't know.
I better start actually playing some games then.
Yeah, we should really, shouldn't we?
So far on my rough list of games of for Game of the Year, I think I've got two games that were released last year.
Oh, that's good.
Which is good, you know.
So that's coming up in the next episode. If you're listening to this and you're going, where's this game or that game? Then don't worry, we do have an honourable mentions list. Sean, would you like to rattle through them?
Yes, okay. So these are the games that we all... I mean, I might have to throw this out to a couple of other people because some of these games I'm scratching my head at myself. But Rainbow Six, absolute classic from back in the day. Half-Life, obviously. Singularity, so I put this on there. I don't know if anyone else has ever played this game. It came out from... Activision was sent out to die at the same time as Call of Duty about time traveling. It was brilliant. Had an amazing multiplayer game if you could ever get a match, but it was top notch. Shadow Warrior and the second one, which are both brilliant. Counter-Strike, obviously.
Yeah.
Whoop, whoop.
The original Halo.
Yes.
Yes.
I think, I don't know who. Yes.
That'll be me.
Doom. The new Doom.
The new Doom is badass, man. That is such a great game. I highly, highly recommend it. It's not the best first person shooter I've made, but it's a cracking start to a possible, you know, rehash of that franchise. And I highly recommend it.
Good. BioShock 2. Did I put this one on there? Because I guess I'm the only person here that likes BioShock 2.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I liked BioShock 2 more than the other two. I just don't like it more than Duke Nukem 3D, Wolfenstein, New Order, Unreal Tournament, or Alien vs. Predator. Doom Classic, obviously. Who put this one on? Was that you, Roscoe?
Yeah, well, you got to put it in there, haven't you?
Yeah, the same as we put Quake and Quake 3 Arena on there.
Mate, Quake is awesome. As Quake 3 Arena was the first online multiplayer game I ever played on my Dreamcast. Wow. And that was the first time with my 56k modem that they bundled in. It was a wonderful experience.
Sounded?
Yeah, it was.
I could hear the emotion in your voice there.
That was beautiful, man.
Halo Reach.
Halo Reach is you know, it's not the best shooter in the world, but it's a really cracking kind of end to Bungie's time, and I really think that it doesn't get enough credit. I think it's really, really, really bloody good, and it should be honoured a lot more than it is.
Call of Duty World at War.
Yeah.
That's an absolute cracker.
First brought zombies to us as well.
Yes. It also had that amazing enemies at the gate segment.
Yeah.
In the fountain. That's just a fantastic level. I mean, it is a complete rip-off of the film, but it's still great. Battlefield 4?
Well, so, I thought Battlefield 3 was better, but, you know.
I haven't played it.
Battlefield 4 is amazing.
I'm all over Battlefield. Yeah, I see you on it quite a bit, or I did see you on it quite a bit. Battlefield Bad Company 2 as well, which I was so close to putting on as my pick, but ended up with Junior Con 3D instead. Wolfenstein Old Blood, the sequel to The New Order. Fantastic. It's a pretty good game. It's not as good as The New Order, I don't think. Black, who put Black on?
I did. Black rocks.
Black was great.
I never played Black.
Black was bloody great.
Who put Bulletstorm on this list?
Let me tell you something about Bulletstorm, Sean, okay?
Oh, no, no.
I don't give a shit what anyone says. I rented Bulletstorm. I think I rented it off Love Film years and years ago. And I had an absolute blast with that game.
Right. Fair enough.
Yeah.
I hated Bulletstorm. game is trying to... I really just couldn't... The main character... Okay, I've totally fucked this situation up, guys. I've killed all the crew. Guess what, guys? We're going to have to go on a mission. No, just fuck off and die. Anyway, Dishonored, and obviously yes. The sequel, which is I'm about to start. Has anyone started it yet?
I've started it, yeah. I've got probably in the second sequence now. It's very Dishonored. It's nothing. No, so far, I've not seen anything new. But that's not necessarily a bad thing, because Dishonored is superb.
Yeah. Okay. And Titanfall 2.
Yeah, man. Cool. It's not, it needs to stand the test of time for a while, but it's the campaign. I'm not finished it yet, but I'm currently plowing through it, and it's just brilliant, mate. It's just brilliant. I cannot believe that this is the first campaign in the series, because the level design is so good. It's so intricate. It's so clever. It requires a hell of a lot of patience and concentration. It reminds me of Portal a little bit in some areas. It's properly worth playing, my friends, listening to this.
I've just started Titanfall 2. And it's so far, it's fantastic. The one thing that is impressing me so much is just the shooting mechanics. It feels solid. Obviously, they've had Titanfall 1 to get things right and improve upon. But EA have definitely hit something there with Titanfall 2, and it looks absolutely stunning.
It does. It looks stunning on our pros, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it does.
It's ridiculous how good it looks. to like some points. At one stage, it was kind of like I was looking down the ravines on like the first sort of level where you first get into your Titan, and just looking at the rock formations and the rock faces, and it's just it's a whole another level of graphic fidelity. It's just great. Plus the online is brilliant.
It's up there with Uncharted 4. It's probably one of the best looking games on PS4. But hey, Sean, you wouldn't know about that, would you?
No.
But Titanfall 2 is available at HMV for £20 on Friday. So,
unfortunately, though, this podcast will be going out after Black Friday.
Yeah, that's true.
So
we drew that deal you missed.
Yeah, so ha, in your face.
I do hope that you went out to HMV on Black Friday and got Titanfall 2.
Yeah, or hopefully the people listening received an email from Sony giving them 43% off the game.
Damn. They really want to push Titanfall 2 out the door, don't they?
I think Titanfall came out at the wrong time.
Oh, definitely.
It literally came out like a week after. Was it a week after or a week before Call of Duty?
It was a week after Battlefield and a week before Call of Duty.
Yeah. So it's like, well nobody's going to pick up this game that didn't have a campaign before, was an Xbox exclusive when Battlefield 1 was coming out, which everybody got to play, even though I'm sure loads of people played Titanfall 2 on the technical tests. I don't know why it got released at that time. If they would have waited another 2 or 3 weeks afterwards, it probably would have sold hundreds and thousands of copies.
Yeah, it would have gone pretty gangbusters on everyone who's just finished Infinite Warfare and wants someone else to play.
Well, exactly. But
hey, it's still available now, so go get it, my friends. Absolutely. Go get it. So that brings episode 2 of Thumb Wars to an end. The best first-person shooter we have chosen is Half-Life 2. Which I think we're all in agreement is a very good choice, which gives Paul another win.
Raw.
Which is like two for two now. He's on
two
it.
Two for two.
He's
on it. It's got to be a downward hill now from now on because, it's bound to happen. So.
We're going to see what happens with the next episode, which is 2016 Game of the Year. We're each going to choose 4 games from this year that we consider truly exceptional. I'm sure there are 4 out there somewhere.
Somewhere.
So, our thanks to Mrs. Stu Shortland.
Good night.
Mr. Paul Collett.
See ya.
And Mr. Sean Davies.
Toodles.
Oh, the energy. The energy. Thanks.
Ticked off about Unreal Tournament.
I am as well. I failed college because of Unreal Tournament.
And now Sean's failed Dumb Wars because of Unreal Tournament.
Exactly.
It's on you, Sean. Remember next time. Thanks for listening, everyone.
Yes, I will.
Until next time, bye-bye.